we hopefully move it to Parks and Bio monitors where we are looking at the monitoring heat that the vaccine or the vaccine that we have absorbed, because it tells, depending on how much heat, and it tells you whether the vaccine is still potent or not. And we are using COVID packs, because we've seen that the ice packs condition was not being done very well, and a lot of vaccines would freeze while being stored in the vaccine carrier or in the cold box. So we moved from the use of ice packs to use of cooling packs. On stock management, we used to use stock control cards from at all levels, but now it's national, provincial, as well as at district level. We are using the stock management tool using the computer, which is computer based. But at the old facility, they are still using the paper based stock books. Then we are also trying to link this stock management for DHIS tool. Then we have also moved from the single dose to multi-dose against the use of the EVM, and then we have developed SOPs that would guide or direct our health workers on how to utilize the fridges, how to manage the vaccines, and so on. This is a very busy sketch slide, but it is just trying to tell you how busy the polio and then issues were going on from 1995 up to where we are today. But maybe what I want to point out is maybe the formation of the expert committee, the committee, polio committee in 1996. This one that look at the classifying of polio cases, that look at the containment, that look at maybe the recommendations to IRC when you know this polio FDM journey. Then I also want to point to you on the last case in 1989 that was seen, and that was that up to date we haven't had any new case being reported. Then our laboratory, you know, which is looking after Zimbabwe and Malawi, is doing very well, being accredited. I think WHO nominated how we performed last year. But all along, I think we've been performing very well, above 90% every year when they have been assessed. Then we have the case-based surveillance that started in 1996, where we are looking at each and every AFP case reported, making sure that it is tested, investigated, we get results, and if we are not AFP, it is followed up to make sure that it is not an AFP case and it's not a polio case. Then for our indicators, we are performing very well on surveillance, where our detection rate is at 22.4 per 100,000 population under 15, over and above the expected 2 per 100,000. And then our tumor accuracy is well above the 80% line, because we have 99%. Then the coverage for OPV, we are also at 89% in 2018. sure that we don't miss anyone. And as of now, we are actually using a more liberal case definition where we are saying anybody with Russian fever suspect measles, so that we don't miss cases. We had a measles. We introduced measles rubella in 2015 in the country as a catch-up campaign, where we looked at children 9 months to about 15 years. And then after that, we introduced the measles second dose. We are aware that measles has got an efficacy of 85%. So we always, remain with maybe 50% pool of susceptibles. So by introducing the second dose, the country would like to see that, maybe those who might have not self-contacted during the 9 month injection, maybe we have a second chance to self-contact with the 18-month dose. This is why you see that we have outbreaks now. We have outbreaks maybe in populations above 5 years, and then those who are already vaccinated, meaning that these are susceptible to have failed to self-contact them. Then in 2017, because the country is in the pre-elimination phase, we had the measles verification committee being established, who are mandated to document the elimination phase process. We are also having the central surveillance for CRIs, which for this is being done at Harare Hospital. Unfortunately, I don't have a lot of data on this one. Then we last had our one IgM case in the country, one which was positive last year in 2018, and one in 83 cases who were VEGA positive. Then we are planning to have a catch-up campaign in 2019, in September, and our target coverage is 95%. It is a follow-up campaign, the one that we did in 2015. So we will be targeting the children 9 to 9 months. MMT is another EPI disease that is targeted for elimination. We had the elimination status in 2000, and by then we were actually vaccinating women of childbearing age. But with time, a lot of women, pregnant women, were getting a lot of ATT. So the ministry then said, we are now just going to look at giving ATT to pregnant women. Again, looking at that coverage, it was also very low, because a lot of the women were just coming in for the TT booster. So the country has now said we will monitor babies born protected from neonatal tetanus. And as we speak, in 2018, our coverage was 89%. The country is going to move from TT now to the use of TD vaccine. It's recommended by NITA, and I think UNICEF is also saying the same. Then the NITA, they are also looking at the 6-year schedule because of this elimination of MNT that we are working on. It is the planning that at least everybody has 6 doses so that they are well protected. Because TT has got the waning, component in it, so that you might think somebody is well protected when they are not. So by giving them 6 doses, I think it has been seen that one would be well protected. When we give vaccines, adverse events do occur, and they are being also monitored. We are targeting 10,000 surviving infants. influence in our program. So we have all that has been reported. They are being investigated as well. And any line is in night. And so far we are 18,000 in 2018. And the reporting is being done. We have come up with the developed manual that directs our health workers on what to do and the activities to do. So the health facility maybe will report and the district, from district, province, and national can go down to actually conduct the investigation. Then we have committees that have been established at provincial and district level to look at adverse events. Because it's one of those things that if we let go, it might actually be detrimental to our program. Then we look at program like financing. I think I've already talked about, you know, the ministry having been able to finance itself. But now we have the traditional vaccines being financed through HDF and the new and other utilized vaccines being supported through GAVI. The ministry is still paying for its co-financing. And because GAVI does not pay for the second dose, we are the ministry's pre-financing measles, the ministry should pay a second dose. Our problem is maybe the limited fiscal space. The ministry has too many personal health issues that are facing it. And EPI is given to the world. And it is difficult maybe to appeal to people if they are well, say they might have some money, or to appeal to somebody to walk a distance if they are well. So it is not an easy program to advocate for until people open their eyes and see that, you know, maybe if we are prevented from disease, then the sicknesses will actually go down. Here, this is maybe we didn't get the thing you are trying to see properly. We're just trying to show what the ministry or what HDF is paying for. Like in 2019, we paid about 1.8 million for the traditional vaccines, and the GAVI are paying about 10 million. For our new and other utilized vaccines, and the country is paying about 1 million for the co-financing. Then the introduction of the new and other utilized vaccine, because it's one of the GIVA goals that we introduce new vaccines. I think we tried to tabulate there. When we started in 2008 to introduce the pentavalent, and in 2012, the PCV, or the pneumococcus. Also in 2012, because of these new vaccines, we moved our schedule from the 3 months where we started to give it 3 months, we started to give it 6 weeks, then 10 weeks, then it was 14 weeks. In 2014, we had the autovirus. In 2015, I think we already talked about that. Then in 2014, we had the demos project for HPV, which we rolled out as a country. Then we are hoping to introduce IPV this coming April. We did not do so in 2016 as it was planned because of the global shortage. I won't talk about the cholera and typhoid, but anyway, they are in the country. Then I think that is the schedule. We were saying maybe 6 weeks, 10 weeks, and 14 weeks. Giving our BCTF back, the OPV1, pentavalent PCV1, the auto one, it's 6 weeks, repeated 10, repeated 14 weeks, aging and PV at 14 weeks, then at 9 months and 18 months, give measles and rubella, as well as DTP booster and OPV booster. I think I've said our NITAG is already discussing and recommending ministry to adopt the hepatitis B vet clause, as well as the TCV and the TB6 clause. The operational studies that have been conducted through the program, we were having challenges with our sector. So some studies were done in that area to find out what their challenges are, what they want, what they don't want. I think the issue that came up with that, you know, maybe they believe in what they believe in. And also for those that might have, you know, decided to come to the hospital, the health workers would actually maybe also broadcast that, you know, they would now come and so they did not like that. They like their confidentiality, they like their privacy. So that's something that we are doing. And then also the engagement with the leadership, and also making immunization mandatory through a law, because one of the leaders actually said to us, I go to Tanzania, because in Tanzania you cannot go there without, you know, the yellow fever. I get vaccinated when I go there because it's law. So in Zimbabwe you should also make laws. So this is one area that, you know, maybe the ministry is trying to address through the Public Health Act. And we still feel maybe more needs to be done, because the school health policy should also maybe say for every child who enters school, we must have the vaccination. Maybe that way will go a long way. The next opportunity study, we're looking at how children are being missed because of these stations within the health institute. The mothers might not want to go and queue here for TB, queue there for malaria, queue there for immunization. So we tend to have a lot of missed opportunities. Also with our private sector, we also found out that we had some missed opportunities because the mothers or caregivers choose to go to the private sector because they are running away from queues. But if the private practitioner is not giving vaccinations as part and parcel of their practice, and they then ask the mothers to go back, we have also found out that at times we miss some of the children. In the comprehensive EA review, it was actually looking at the whole program as a whole, and a lot of things came up. And I think what was vivid was maybe the data quality, that our data is not very good because we're missing some data, and the completeness and timing that I've already updated through. And I think maybe also some of the tools were not updated by then. And then the rate strategy evaluation, here we were trying to look at, you know, those districts that we were doing, those we intend to roll out, what they have learned and so on. And we found out that, you know, where it has been implemented, the community engagement has been good. And the health workers are quite, you know, confident to do the immunization program. And it's not just taking care of the immunization program. It's actually a broad-based strategy that actually takes care of all other programs. Although integration is not as easy, like we have noted, that this is at the health facility level, they found it working well. We have also had a KAP study, where we were looking at social behavior change in communication. This still being, you know, analyzed. We are hoping that, you know, once it's finished, it will inform the communication strategy for our program, and maybe to assist us with the behavior change for immunization. For every new introduction, new vaccine that was being introduced, some post-introduction evaluation was being done. Then we had the UK survey, the mix, the VHS, that would also look at EPI. Then effective vaccine management, we were looking at, you know, how effective are the vaccine being managed. And I think the last one that we did, the weaker areas in temperature monitoring, which tried to move from the old methods into newer methods, and this is improved not greatly. Then the data quality assessment and surveys, we also looked at, you know, issues that were being discussed there, like the tools that were not updated, the register was not struggling, we haven't actually updated it. And then we were also feeling for the next to say there's so many registers to fill in, and they complained that, you know, EPI, we fill in the card, we fill in the register, then we also fill in the tally sheet. There is a lot of documentation, and the nurses are not adequate. Some achievement for the program, we were thinking we are on track to achieve the super goals. We have the polio certification, like I've already alluded to. We also moved from TOPB to DOPB and IPB. Attained the neonatal children examination, introduced the MRI and the MSD, and then introduced the new vaccines. We also contributed to the reduction of morbidity and mortality between PPDs. And we have functional committees at the NITAC, the Measles Verification Committee, the polio committees that guide the program and the ministry in the vaccines that we have adopted to implement the society. And this is just to show, you know, it's not only about EPI, but we have also played the role with EPI to bring that reduction that we can see there. From 2000, I think looking at the other five modalities, upper one, we had about 106,000 items, and in 2015, we had 71, so we are ahead of that. And the infant mortality rate also from 65%, and we are ahead of the CPA, we also contributed. This one is rather busy, but it also just saying, you know, we are within Chibok. Goals. And on this one, I was looking at the other five children that suffered from pneumonia versus, you know, the PCV introduction. Because we introduced the PCV in 2024. And so, when you look at the blue bars, that is another popular, the light blue bars, the very big. I'm looking at the other five population. Then the red are the pneumonia that the children are suffering, and you can see them actually trailing down. Then the darker blue, that is the PCV, the children that actually received PCV in that area. And then the line is actually our coverage. And like I said, we've actually plateaued. Looking